You don't really think that was warm, do you? All right. No plan B. So I'm going to talk a little bit about myself first. If you read what's up here, this is sort of a statement, a blanket statement about what I do. But clearly it's just four sentences. I've been a commercial photographer. Well, let's put it this way. I've made my living in photography since 1980 when I was around 21. And that's the only way I've ever made a living, whether it's writing, editing, sequencing, selling my work. I've been in three non-Maverick galleries, major galleries in New York, Chicago, and Houston, which I'm, by the way, no longer in for a multitude of reasons, mostly because I seem to work better on my own. You know, in your report card where it said works and plays well with others? Apparently it didn't work. So I liked everybody at the galleries, but it wasn't for me. But I've been shooting since 1980. I was the first assignment photographer for the Image Bank in the mid-80s. In my early 20s, I got to travel the world on their dime and shoot assignments and shoot for myself at the same time. So this book, No Plan B, is actually a retrospective. I've had six previous books, but this is a retrospective, and I'll tell you where it came from before we did a little photo show. Leica had come to me, Leica came to me, I guess about 3 or 4 months ago and said, we'd love you to do a show with us. Do you have any ideas? And I use Leicas, by the way, I only use Leicas for myself, that's all, and I shoot film. I do use digital cameras commercially, but they don't do me any favors, so I'm not saying what kind. It was Canon. So I use Canon for... And by the way, the reason I use Canon is I always use Nikons for film, but when I was at CBS, I was a director of photography in the advertising division at CBS. When we switched over to digital at that time, and I don't know the years, it could have been 1940, but when it started to become a thing, Canon gave you more bang for your buck. Literally, that's why I went from Nikon to Canon. So that's why we still use Canon cameras. And they're great. They are great. But I shoot Leica for myself, and I shoot film. And so anyway, Leica came to me, and they want to do a show. And we're kind of shooting around what the show would be. And he joked about a retrospective because I'm so much older than he is. The guy from, his name is Tom Smith. He runs Leica Academy in North America. Anyway, the retrospective idea came up. I happen to own a publishing company called Peanut Press with my partner, Ashley Stoll. And, well, actually, I'm a co-founder. And we said, well, let's put the book out for the show ourselves because we're like the best. And so we made the book, No Plan B, ourselves. We published other books for other people, including Richard Bram, who was here in the audience, who's a very good street photographer. And he flew in from London just for this. You guys believe that, by the way? Anyway, so that's what we do. So we decided to make the book ourselves instead of outsourcing it because we just do the best we can. We use a publishing house, a printer called Meridian Printing, who makes books for Lee Friedlander, Richard Avedon, Irving Penn, everybody, because they're the best in the United States, and we wanted to keep it here. So that's how the book came about from Leica. The show will be in February and March in New York City, and then maybe beyond. We're discussing that now. So this little show is more about my photographs in general, because everything I do is the same. I take the pictures for the same reasons, and as we go through them, I'll talk about why I take these pictures for myself. And by the way, there's no commercial work in here. It's all personal work. Over the last 20-something years, I foolishly said it's 1993 to 2016, which is like 23 years. I should have just said 91, so I could say 25 years. So now I awkwardly always have to say 23 years the book represents. But that was actually a misstep. I should have said 92. All right. Everybody's read this? You did your homework? So this is me. And this is me at Photo Eye being happy, because I'm funny. Kudelka, maybe one of the greatest living photographers, certainly in the top three or four in my book. This is what he says about photography. And I sort of kind of feel this way, but that would sort of, then why would I be here, right? So I'm going to go against what he says, even though it's what I think. And hopefully my pictures say more than I can. And the way I feel about that is, if you don't know who Lewis Hine is, look him up. Same for Kudelka. He nailed this in the 20s or 30s whenever he said this, and it's true. If we could write, I'm sure most photographers I know, if they were good writers, would probably do more of that than, although I know people who are both. Jason Eskenazi, who wrote the afterword of my book, is an amazing photographer and apparently a great writer. So we have two in one there. So let's get to pictures. And by the way, this is my part where I say, this is your last chance to leave the room. You get it? So, and this is during Sandy. Or right after Sandy. So maybe it's poignant. Okay, this is the new book. I take pride in the fact I'm a photographer, so I actually photographed the book cover for our website. This is the limited edition. Isn't that cool effect? Look at that. Ooh, it's like magical. Dun, 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 dun. All right, so, and we also did a limited edition. And just so you know, this book, it was expensive to produce. We printed in the United States. We bound it in the United States. We did everything in the United States. Therefore, it cost probably twice as much as if we did it in China. But we wanted to do it in the United States for a number of reasons. Primarily, this printer is the best I could find, and we can actually go on press and control what's going on. We'll talk a little bit about that at the end if you're interested. So I made a limited edition of the book, and I actually made a silver print. I got nothing against digital, but I don't sell digital prints unless it's for a charity or certain things I've done in the past. I sell silver prints. So you get a silver print with this book for the unbelievably low price of $150, which if you think that sounds expensive, go make 11 by 14 print at a, get somebody to hand print it for you. It's the price of the book and the print. So anyway, this is available. We have a couple here if you want to buy them at the end. I'm not pushing it, but it's the way we make our money back at Peanut Press. Okay. So what I do is I walk around with a camera all the time. And I take pictures of everything. I shoot film. So if you're a photographer, you understand the challenge of using HP5 in the subway. We're shooting basically at wide open. I use two lenses. I use a 21 and a 24. I use Leica lenses. This is photographer stuff. I figure you guys know something about photography, so. And I don't say that in a sort of arrogant way, because it really doesn't matter what you know about photography. It's about taking pictures. But I use a 21 and a 24 99% of the time. I keep bodies with one camera, with one lens dedicated to it. So I have a couple with 24s, a couple with 21s, and that's what I carry around. And I shoot HP5 because I think Kodak, and I'm not going to say the F word, up Tri-X. So I don't use Tri-X anymore. I had a bunch in my freezer, and once that was gone, I use HP5. It looks better to me. It looks like older Tri-X. Anyway, so this is probably 5.6 of the, you know, no, this is probably 2.8 at like an eighth. So anyway, this is just me looking through the window of a subway. And it's all just about, I want to find this dude because I think, I have two kids. If somebody had a picture of me like this with my kid, I would love to get it and I would give him a print. And I don't even like giving away prints, but I would like to give him a print. That's just a lie. I give away prints all the time. Okay. This is, can anybody guess where this is? I know, it's written on the bottom. My favorite question I get on this one is that a window? I'm like, yeah, it's a window. That's a boat from 1870 sailing past this building. All right, anyway. What I like in photography is a couple of things. In my photographs, I like there to be some mystery, some humor, some irony, maybe even originality. So I think there's a theme in all my pictures, and I actually put out a book called All My Pictures Look the Same, because I kind of think they do. Entering the room is my cousin, who is quite young and apparently retired. This is what we all want to be, retired young guy. Okay. So anyway, that's what. So this picture kind of fits in my theme. And interestingly enough, when photographers buy my work, actual photographers, this is like one of the two or three most of them buy, which I think is interesting. See, I was on the beach, and this guy every effing morning would come up with the same case of beautiful jewelry and would try to sell it to me. So I said to him, I'll tell you what, just open your thing and let me take a picture. It's the Maltese Falcon. And I will buy some from you. And I had him make 20 bracelets for me that I gave out to people as gifts from Mexico. So I don't know, there's some sort of metaphor about life in this picture. Let's get real deep here. Speaking of metaphor, I don't say where I took this picture, but it's funny, when I sell this print, people also often go to me, yeah, right. I don't know what they mean, but I'll take it. Ah, okay. This picture, this is a relatively new picture. And by the way, 2013 is like a week ago to me. I'm 58. Everything sort of mushed together after I passed about 35. So those 20 years or so are a blend. This feels really new. I always want to take a picture of a window in a motel or a hotel room, most likely because of Robert Frank's picture through the window in Montana. So I'm clearly copying him, but so what? And this was my version. And I put this up on Facebook. And I think the first day it went up, three people bought 16 by 20 prints. And one of the people wrote to me, oh my God, it's so sad. I said, why is it sad? It's like, well, did the guy jump out the window? And I'm like, whoa. No, it's just me copying Robert Frank, but all right. I'll take your money. All right, next picture. Okay. This picture's taken a long time ago. See, 99 feels like a long time ago to me. Me and a friend, Joe, who comes up periodically in my photographs, were traveling through Texas taking pictures, and I was working on a book idea, actually. I love books, photo books. To me, that's the ultimate. Shows are transient, and they're fine, and they're stupid. Oh, no, they're not. I'm actually right, because I'm having one next year. But I think they're sort of not like books. Books, you can sit in your chair, you can look at the pictures for days, you know. So we're on the road, and we go to some little town in Texas, and we need a room. And I remember the woman going, oh, we don't really have any rooms. I'm like, this is like in the middle of nowhere. How do you not have rooms? And apparently there was like, you know, a rubber band convention. It was something. But we have the honeymoon suite. So this is the honeymoon suite, and me and Joe stayed in the honeymoon suite. And this was basically, it was a box room, like old crappy motels, except it had this off of it for the honeymooners. So this is the honeymoon suite, and look at they even vacuumed it. You see little vacuum lines? So I love this. This is one of my favorites. Can we make fascist jokes about Trump, or we're not doing that yet? Ooh, quiet. All right. No, he's awesome. So I saw this sign on the beach one day, but it didn't look right, and I took some pictures of it, and it just wasn't there. And generally, once I've seen something and couldn't get a picture of it, I go home. Fast forward X amount of time, I'll say 5 years, it was probably more like 9 months or 3 months. All these clouds are rolling in from the beach, and I kind of lived by the beach, and I drove to it as quickly as I could, and I went to this spot. And I ran out and took this picture. And I love when there's clouds behind something because it adds like fake drama. It's like the music in the movie. Like if you turn off the movie's just boring. So this is music. And actually, what's interesting to me is the most important part of this image, besides the obvious, like that's, what does it even mean, is this and this. This is like in my mind how composition works. And without those two things, it wouldn't be right. And I don't know why. Even though I like teach students and work with stuff, I would say that, and I'd say, and I don't know why, and they'd go, no, really. In my mind, this is welcoming us to somewhere, and I don't know where, and I can't make it out. And I feel like it's in Texas. Welcome to Vision. You know, like the old joke, like, hey, how did you know? That's what that is, and a visual version of that. And he's trying desperately to figure out what does it really say. Listen, I've had this for like 20 years. You're not gonna figure it out. All right, so I grew up in a town on Long Island called Jericho. And I felt like growing up I was on another planet. And then I went back there and it is another planet. Okay, so this. Wait, this isn't funny. This is a grand statement. This is Sartre and Camus, come on. All right, yeah, exactly. Here's something interesting. This is the road to Pahrump. You don't know where Pahrump is, but it's a maybe you do know where Pahrump is.
Yeah.
Who lives it? Does anyone know the famous celebrity that lives in Pahrump?
No,
sir.
But there's like a place where people shoot cars there and everything.
I'm sure. It's between Vegas and Death Valley. I'm sure they do a lot of bad things.
Yeah.
Who was that madam who was in L.A. who got busted? She lives there and grooms dogs. Heidi Fleiss lives in Pahrump. And it's in my book, and it's one typo we found after the book. I spelled Pahrump wrong. But it's actually, this is wrong. It's supposed to say Road to Pahrump. I effed this up, too. All right. Anyway, to me, this is America, you know? It's Abby. This is America to me. You know, American flags and Christmas and dying trees. No, actually, it's not, right? These are, what are these things called? Oh, that's a Joshua tree? What's this, the cactus that does this? Saguaro. Oh, okay. So I would call this a saguaro, but I have all that stuff. You know, here's a funny story. The picture's going to, I'll save the story for the picture. So I woke up, I live in Long Island, and I woke up and I looked out my window and I didn't want to get up and it was foggy and I had to find something to take a picture of. So I just drove around really quickly and this is really a picture of a truck. You see the truck, guys?
Yes.
Yeah, but it's not, right? No, but this is really a picture of a truck. I desperately tried to find something. So I like this picture. All right, this one comes with a story like the boots. This is one of my favorite pictures for many reasons. It's my kid. It's a fine line between photographing your family and making a photograph. And there's very few photographers, I think, who do it really well. If you guys know the book, The Animals, that was because Winogrand was taking his kids to the zoo. I mean, literally, and you know, Danny Lyon does it. Obviously, Robert Frank did it. A lot of people photograph their children. A friend of mine, Paris Vizzone, photographs her family. and it's legit. Like, they look like real photographs. And this, to me, is a real photograph. It happens to have my kid in it, as opposed to a picture of my kid that's in a photograph. For whatever that means, he's standing on a rock, and he's going like this. And that's our, I'm sitting on the deck of our cabin up in Maine. I was giving a show out west, doing this picture, and somebody goes, oh my God, is that person drowning? It's like the jumping, I don't know how the woman got from New York to Santa Fe to say the same comment, but I never thought, so now of course, for the rest of my life, it's gonna be like, oh, it's the Max drowning picture. Max was a good kid, I remember him well, no. All right, this is, see, they all sort of look the same, right? They're all the same thing. Driving around in Florida, this hand or whatever was reaching in to rip down the top of the dance. And when we came back, it was gone. So for me, this is like a lot of things. I got to use my cloud trick, which, you know, doesn't always work. And I don't know, this is one of my favorite pictures, and I'm not even sure why. There's something about the, maybe the font, the topless font and the closed and everything. All right, I like this one. Is there anybody who doesn't know what these are? I'm curious, and this is genuinely, I'm curious. Do you not know what these things are? How cool is that? My son was visiting from school with a bunch of his friends, and I was playing records, and they looked at the records going, how do you know where the next song starts? So like, they didn't know that, but you guys know what an outhouse is. Oh, I wrote outhouse, I screw everything up. So I'm at Acoma, which is the oldest continuously inhabited reservation, or maybe, no, it's not called a reservation, I don't know, place, yes, in the United States. It goes back like 800 years. And it's, you know, it's, this is a, sort of a, it, they have a lot of rules up there because I don't know why they have the rules, but they have the rule. You can't photograph the church, and I'm down with that. That's cool if you don't want me to. So while everybody's looking at this church and not photographing, I sort of wandered a little bit and started photographing the outhouses, and the dude who was in charge came running over and go, no, no, you can't photograph that. So I'm like, church and outhouses, check. But I got the picture. And this is great. The guy who works by the deli where I get my like coffee in the morning, he was looking at my pictures and he goes, look at that, it's just like society. I'm like, what do you mean? And this is just recently. He goes, the rich guys have the better view on the top and the other ones, it never crossed my mind, so. Isn't that kind of a cool perspective? See, it's you get old showing your pictures to photographers all the time. They're so photography. This guy really saw the truth, maybe. All right, so this is the Arctic. So these dudes, I've been to the Arctic 7 times. I went the first time on an assignment when I was young and 40 below wasn't quite that bad. The last time I went was in 97 and 40 below was, it was horrible. So anyway, this is the middle of the night and I had to get up and, you know, the weird thing is when you're there and the sun circles. So this isn't super cool, cold, but you don't know what time it is. You really do lose the sense of time. Sun circling, I got up and these guys are hanging out. And it suddenly occurred to me, oh yeah, you have to be on polar bear watch 24 hours a day, or you know, you're like a Larson cartoon where they crunch through the thing. So yeah, this polar bear watch, and by the way, this is shot in color. I converted it to black and white so I could cheat and use it in my black and white photos. But this is color. A little vignetting there, I don't even know why. Probably some crap, there's no Nikon people though, right? I think it was some crappy Nikon thing and I had like vignetting from the thing. Nikon gave me winterized cameras the first time I went and they stopped working almost immediately. And my Leicas, which were not winterized, did work, so. Nikon in the 80s though, of course they're great now. Oh, by the way, notice the gas can is how you hold up the tent. Yeah. I think that's cool.
Did the film crack in the cold?
Does the film?
Did the film crack?
So here's the key to the film. I never cracked any film. The bigger issue I was, so Ira Block, who was here recently, is the guy I called in 1986 when I was first going up there, because he did stuff for National Geographic. And we were at the same agency, the same place was repping us. And he told me all this stuff to do. Number one thing, which I never know, leave everything out frozen. Never bring it in anywhere, because it'll condensation will get on, then it'll freeze again. So you leave everything outside, you Ziploc bag it, all those tricks that I guess now we know. And what Iris said to me was, static is a bigger enemy than the film cracking. When you rewind it, don't use motor drives to rewind it, do it very slowly. So I never cracked any film, and I never got static. But yeah, it's a big issue at 40 below. By the way, everything is an issue at 40 below. When you're sleeping at 40 below, if you get up and go like this, the cold air shoots in and you have an hour of like, oh, okay, I gotta get warmth again. So like you don't pee at night because it'll take you till the next day before. And by the way, when you're there at 40 below, it's dark. This is Elijah Panapakuchu. He was my guide every single time I went up to Baffin and Bylot Island. And my younger son's middle name is Elijah after this guy. And this is Elijah going, Elijah's like a little guy who's magical. Like he can change spark plugs without gloves on at 40 degrees below zero. He can do things that you just can't do. So cool dude. This is, okay, so in the Arctic, you travel on the ocean because it's frozen, but on land, like this is Bylot Island, they build these little hunter's shacks. And it's sort of a socialist environment in that everybody just shares everything. If that's socialism, I don't know enough about it. I mean, I do, but I don't want to get into it. But like, so this is a cabin everybody shares. And so the gun's out front, because that's what you use to protect yourself. And that's caribou fur, which you put on the bottom of the kumatuk, which you're dragged along in, because caribou fur is hollow. And when you lay on it, it bounces warm up, and it's the only way to stay warm. So that's Elijah's cabin one morning. The Joe, the previously mentioned Joe, who's our pre-press guy for Peanut Press, decided to get up one morning. He wanted to eat a fish. So Elijah, using a shortwave, I guess, up there, shortwave radio, found somebody who was a group going out fishing, and they came and picked up Joe and took him, and that's an Arctic char. And they gave him one, and as he walked off their sled and walked towards me, I said, freeze. I took the, oh, a pun. And I said, and I took his picture, and then we went and ate that thing, and it was maybe the best sushi I've ever had in my life. Frozen char. Oh, by the way, that's caribou. That's what they get. You know, Patagonia outfitted me with all this stuff, and I love Patagonia. But yeah, at 40 below, nothing works except caribou. You're better off naked under the caribou than wearing 18 layers of Patagonia and going like, because you'll just be cold and uncomfortable. You know, I don't want to focus on the cloud trick, and I probably shouldn't have said it. It's like saying, hey, you cut the lady in half. But I do this a lot, apparently. But you got to find it. So this is in the Mojave. Oh my God, now she's like the one who walked in and everybody's looking at her. This is in the Mojave Desert. And as soon as we got in the desert, I got this picture, and I kind of said to Joe, who was with me, I said, I think I'm done for the next week and a half, because I don't know if I could take a better picture than this. And it, for me, this was about the black and white stripes and one light bush and a dark bush and the wires and everything. And I didn't really see it, because like in real life, apparently there's these colors. But I think I knew that that's what it was. And so this is an oldie. Yeah, 2003, what is that? That's like, is that 20 years ago? No. Mathletes are here. This I call my son Theo, because I came home one day and he had done that thing in the snow that, you know, we do as a snow angel. And as I was walking up, I saw my shadow and I made believe I was grabbing his hand, and that gets aww. Yeah. Now he's 15 and he goes, he likes being in this stuff. You know, it's funny. I was in, where was I? Oh, I was at Photo Eye, which is like the best photography bookstore. And I was speaking and doing this whole thing. So we flew out there, and the magazine out there, their equivalent of the Times Magazine section, did a cover story on me. That's right, cover. It was a cover story. And my older son, who's completely jaded, was on the cover. So he's all, you know, every box that you saw with the thing, and he's like, you know, he's like 13 at the time. And Theo, who's my littler guy, he had more pictures in the magazine. So it became this thing where there was like four Theos and two Maxes. Max got the cover. All right. Theo, again, we're in Italy. And Theo goes, make me look like a cool Italian kid. So I said, all right. He had the white shirt, and we were probably going to some restaurant. I said, just sort of like run down the street. And I was running backwards, and I got the cool Italian kid picture. All right, so this seems to be a popular item of mine. And it's, by the way, Theo's least favorite picture. He hates it. But I think he just hates the fact that I sell it a lot, and it gets press. So again, here's, and this is, I can tell a story about why I shoot film. This is why I shoot film. I shoot film because I shot this about an eighth of a second at 2.8. And if you look at the little flag and the blur and just sort of she's sharp, if I shot this digitally, it would all be sharp. And I probably would have liked it, but it wouldn't have felt the same. It wouldn't feel like I'm still stuck in the 50s. So, and you know, aesthetically, maybe I am, I don't know. That's why I like Russia, or used to like Russia. But anyway, this is really about why I shoot film. This demonstrates it, I think. This was an exercise that I actually liked the picture. It's in the lobby of the Chrysler Building where my office is. And I was using an old Contax 2 or 3 with a Zeiss lens that I had just gotten from the 50s. It was like the first 21 ever made by Zeiss. And I tried to take a picture with no meter. And I was waiting for the guy's head to sort of go in front of a little bit of light. And I got it. So this is my I'm proud of myself picture. Is this an awe picture? All right, so that's my older son going, I have a great idea for a picture. He made me walk out of the hotel, walk down the street to a tree, and he put his hand like that. And it's actually an album cover. So there you go. He was born in 97. He's 5. Right? Hmm. Best comment of this all time is, did you bring it with you? Like they thought I didn't? Come on, of course. This is, you know, it's cheaper than hotels. I found this in the desert. I love the desert. I didn't bring it with me, but I slept there. And I didn't. That's not true. thank God you showed up. Because they were all just quiet, sort of ignoring me. I don't know what this is about. I've heard so many interpretations. I just remember seeing it. I think I lied. I don't say California anymore. I don't know where I took it. I think I say California. Sometimes I change the places because I want to have like another place in it. Like if I didn't have a picture of Mississippi. I have one that says Mississippi because I don't think I ever took one there. All right, so here's that story. So the story is Stephen Dater Gallery in Chicago. Big deal, high end, you know, the opposite of Maverick. Gallery was used to represent me. And they actually put out my first book in 2003. You know, I get to brag. Ann Tucker, you know, the biggest deal in photography, wrote the afterword, okay? Just saying. Be like Derek Jeter teaching your kids how to play baseball, if you're from New York. Anyway, so Dater calls me up and goes, all right, you have this picture, which you'll see. Oh, was it the horse? No, it wasn't the horse. And said, the print says 1992 on it, but your book says 1993. I said, yeah. He goes, well, which was it? I said, who cares? He goes, the person buying your print. I said, what does it say on the print? And he goes, 92. I said, yeah, that was the right year. The book's wrong. It's a little funnier than that. All right, this is where this picture stays in the show because this is Midland, Texas, and I ate a steak smelling oil the whole time. Yeah, it was gross. All right, so this is called Turtle in Turkey, and it's not a turtle, it's a tortoise. And this is the picture, by the way, that got Ann Tucker. This taught me a lot, this photograph, about myself and about photography. So when did I take this? 97? That's probably true. And actually, it might be earlier, but let's say 97. And I'm with Ann Tucker, and she wrote the thing for the book, and she had bought this photograph of mine at a show. And when I asked her to write the afterword for the book, she's like, well, I don't really write afterwards unless the museum is publishing the book and blah, blah, blah. I said, what are all those pictures and that turtle? And anyway, she finally agreed to do it. And she's actually funny. She goes to me at the end, but you're going to have to pay me. I said, okay. And she goes, the museum needs 12 of your photographs. Okay, that's payment. That's like, I'll pay you to take my pictures. So anyway, and she wrote the afterword and talked about this picture as this struggle she was going through, doing something in Japan with a book and a show and a struggle. And honestly, all this was for me was, can I take a picture of a turtle walking down the road without looking through the camera? So that was everything for me. And that's sort of when I let go of trying to like get people to like my pictures for whatever reason. It's like, I have no say in what people think. So this is the struggle. This is in Moscow. I got to go to Moscow in the early 90s twice on spec for General Electric jet engines. They were going to sell them to Aeroflot, and of course, everybody on the deal knew that Aeroflot, Russia would never pay, and it was all good. So I got to go, but of course they didn't do anything. But so the point is, this is when I started shooting black and white again. I'd been shooting color a lot for the image bank. Lauren, that's for you. And I couldn't take my own pictures anymore. And I thought when I went to Russia, I'd shoot the stuff they wanted in color, put away the camera, and just shoot with my Leicas and black and white film. And if I couldn't do it, and it worked. I felt like, you know, it felt like Robert Frank and all the stuff that I learned about was little Elliot Erwitt, whoever it was. And so then I started shooting, and that's why the book started in 93, because the oldest picture I think is 93. By the way, interesting note, see the candles in the bottom? Those candles are there to stop the flowers from freezing. Interesting. See what you learn? So Joe and I used to have a bet, whenever we went anywhere, I would pay for dinner. I'm making that up. I can't remember. There was some deal we had, but he had to get a haircut there, no matter where we were. He got a haircut in Death Valley. That's how bad that haircut was. There was Joe in Istanbul getting a haircut. He's not in the picture. See, that's... There's Joe again. So I took this picture before I played golf, and that's a really famous golf course in Scotland. And the thing I found peculiar is, A, golf balls are possessive. See the S? I don't know what that means. And... the wall next to that fence is literally this high. So like that fence is really gonna stop you from getting in there? So I just found that funny. And this is clearly funny because if you're from New York, this doesn't go over big in California. Because Sixth Avenue is really long. I wish it said Broadway, because isn't that like the longest show? Oh, Matt Weber, Peanut Press again, everybody. My mishbucha, you're a B&H, mishbucha. All right, Sixth Avenue. Okay, so everybody's taken this picture, right? But this was actually organic in the sense I was laying in the bed in the schmancy hotel I was in and looked out the window while I was looking at the book, go, that's the same thing. So I held it out and took the picture. Arenal. Anybody been in Costa Rica, Arenal? It's basically like you're sleeping next to a nuclear power plant about to go off. It grumbles at night. Everybody goes, yeah, isn't it cool? I'm like, not really. Like, seriously? If this blew up, we're dead, right? Is that how it works? This is my mother-in-law who has really nice pants. And clearly a photographer, look at that. So I have an X-Pan camera, and I've gotten like 5 pictures with it. It cost a fortune, and I've gotten really, but I won't give it up. So there's gonna be a couple of pictures in here with the X-Pan. Does anybody know what an X-Pan is? It's actually a Fuji that Hasselblad put their name on. It's Fuji lens, Fuji body, and it's 2 35mm frames next to each other. So it's panoramic, but it's really 2 together, so you don't get the wide lux distortion. It's a great camera, but I just never can figure out how to use it. This is my other one. This one I really like. And by the way, this is one of the hardest pictures I ever took because I'm really close, and that dude in the middle looked like he was going to peck my face out, but I had to wait for all their heads to kind of align, and I genuinely was like, do I really want to be injured for this? But I was. Oh, the third one. This is cow tushy.
And it is.
Yes. Okay, back to photography. And by the way, this wording is off because we're playing PowerPoint through Keynote. Not that I'm anal or anything, but... All right, so this is an interesting picture to me. So it's Vatican City. So what they did is there's a Raphael above a window where the sun comes in, and nobody can see it. So they'll walk in, and they got their little walkie-talkie things, and it's probably telling them, you know, it's a Raphael, it's a fantastic. And they're all like, what? It's up there. And what is this? There's only 8 of those, right? So they put one in the window. So I love this picture. Pahrump.
I've been there.
You have?
Yeah.
I'm not going to ask. All right, so this is in southern Turkey, Pamukkale, if anybody's been there, which is basically tour buses, and this water's about an inch deep. And Ann Tucker pointed out to me, why is he wearing a mask in water that you can't see in? And honestly, that's not what I thought of. I thought, oh, I don't know. It's probably like the turtle. Can I get this picture? Am I supposed to admit that I don't know what the hell I'm doing? Okay, this one I know what I'm doing. This is guessing game again. Can anybody guess what this place is? It's a rock quarry. And the sea is lying over on the right. Kind of cool, yeah. This is my new favorite truck picture. I love pictures of trucks. I want a truck like this, but there's something about the snow. And by the way, when I'm taking pictures, this is all so critical to me. If you look on the right where that door is and where the light is on the left, I do this thing, and I've said this, I don't know if I say this much publicly, but I really feel the longer I stare through that viewfinder when something's not moving, the more interesting I can make it. And I force this picture to be interesting to me. You guys don't really matter if you like it or not. All right, so does anybody know why these are on the golf course? Who plays golf? Scares away the geese, because they believe these are real wolves coming to eat them. And they just stand there. So I guess geese aren't that smart. You know, I don't know why I put this in here. This is like a trick picture. And I kind of like, you know, if you want to go on a social network and get a lot of likes, make sure you include an umbrella, some smoke, and you're going to get a lot of people who think that's good. I think I keep this picture, one, so I can say that, because it gets a laugh, and two, because I kind of like the shoes. I think the shoes sell it. This is literally in front of the office in the Chrysler building. I said, oh, there's a lot of smoke today. Maybe I'll get something cool. But you know what I mean about that umbrella deal? All right.
Oh, that's great, too.
This is a bubble.
Where's Glinda? It's a Paris bubble.
It's a Parisian bubble, yeah. I like this. And in the book, this came out really good. He did a great job in Separations. Ooh. I'm not saying what this is.
Yeah.
I like this one. Everybody okay. Ominous. Oh, you know, I have this student from Bangkok, and he speaks English, right? But he's Thai. He's actually Indian, but he speaks Thai. And I said something about you know, your picture is very ominous. Like, we're Skyping about how it's working. And he's like, yeah. I said, do you know what ominous means? He's like, no. Isn't that great? But you're speaking English, like you think they know every word you're saying.
Oh, that's great.
This is like one of those ones where I didn't want to go out in the rain, so I had the cab driver drive me around in Paris. You know, I say to friends, I have some friends who are really good photographers. Weber's probably photographing the rain. I don't really have any rain pictures unless I'm in a taxi. That clearly says something about my sort of white privilege. But I want to take more rain pictures. Yeah, this kid has a body. Isn't that odd? This is out of a cab window on my way to the airport. This is one of those ones where my 500 years of experience in photography actually worked. I saw the nun up the block. I'm like, okay, to have any chance of getting this and panning with it, I had to be at least at the 30th. I'll hold it wide open, bang. And when I got home, I got it. I was very proud of it.
Oh, that's great.
This is, this is what I think of when I see this. I think I left my 8-year-old across the street and ran over to take this and said, just wait here. That's wrong, right? You're not supposed to do that?
Is that wrong? Nobody's even looking at the stilt walker.
New York. So to me, this is my ultimate street photography picture. And it's like the scene in Goodfellas. She's looking this way, he's looking that way, and the kid's going, what do you want from me? No, that's the painting. But it just looks like the kid's looking at her like you lost your kid, and she looks like her sister. And so I always like that one. And also I have this thing that I do all the time with arms are hanging, if you look on the right. Obviously none of this is conscious, it's very quick. But when it keeps happening over and over again, I believe there's got to be a reason for it.
What do you mean arms are hanging?
See those like loose arms on the right?
Yeah. Yeah.
I seem to have arms. Abby Robinson is sitting here, told me at SVA when I was a student 340 years ago, that if the thing keeps happening, it's not an accident. See, she's smart, and I still think it. I tell it to my students, what? You want to talk about how good it is, go ahead. No, you don't get to. This is the alfalfa picture. Actually, I was giving a lesson when this was going on, and I actually said to the student, I said, I feel like something's going on here, like something's going to happen. And this particular, yeah, that's what it was. The guy said to me, what do you mean something's happening? And he's actually a musician. I said, stand over there. And I climbed to the top of the steps because I didn't really want him to be like going, what are we doing? And then sort of things happened. And it's weird. Sometimes you just feel like if you stand in a place long enough, something's going to happen. So that's evidence, I think. This is, I don't know why this is in here. I like this picture. It's in Mexico. That's a good reason. There's something sort of simple and beautiful about this box. And at the same time, it feels like a storm's coming. So the whole thing is, it's sort of deserted. Post. All right, so here's it. Enjoy the picture. Go ahead. Flintstones, I get it. This is interesting, and another reason I don't like digital. I was going through Negs looking for something from Turkey, and I found this like 2 years ago, 3 years ago, and I hadn't seen it ever the first time. It's one of my favorite pictures I've ever taken, and I didn't know it existed for like 20 of the years, or no, like 15. And if I had digital, like, would I ever go back? No. The answer is no. I think he's been here, like, looking for that number, right? This still exists, though. Isn't that cool? This is somewhere in Midtown, like, by the MetLife building, maybe? It's not called that anymore. I don't know what it's called. Or maybe it is. It used to be the TWA building, whatever that is. I don't know what it is. I think it's on one side when you're cutting through. But if you notice, the left is, they've already given up that phone. But there are phone books. That's another thing. Kids go, really, phone books. So I always like this picture a little bit, but here you get a story. Not that the others didn't have one. Does everybody see that person on the right in the background? So my son saw it, you know, this is a lot of children influence, and said, oh, that van's gonna abduct that person walking in the background. And that's all I can think about now. Oh, that's good. You know, windowless van. Stranger danger. Okay, so read this. This is about everything I have to say about photography as a reason. I mean, you can make a living as a photographer. You can try. It's great. It's rewarding. You get to see the world. You know, somebody else pays for you to go around the world, and that's awesome, and I love it. It brought me to many places, but at the end of the day, I have a bunch of pictures that for somebody else. I don't even look at them. I got tear sheets. I got all that crap. Doesn't matter to me. This is the stuff that matters because this is my life in pictures. And that's supposed to be the funny one at the end. Now, let me see. Oh. Huh? No. Right? $35 cheap. And that's from Mad Magazine. If you remember Mad, just say 25 cents cheap. So thank you, everybody. Before, clap. I don't know if anybody cares about, does anybody care about the printing process and like start to finish of how you make a book? Because I have about 10 pictures here that might be interesting. Yeah. Should we do that? Okay, good.
Please.
Ooh, very nice. All right, so the thank you's over. Now the first part of our show is now over. Does anybody need to go to the bathroom? You don't get to go. So here's how it works for me. I shoot the pictures. I have a lab that prints for me. Since 1991, Chuck Kelton was printing for me. He retired, and now I have a guy named Laurent Girard. He does my printing over at Griffin Editions, and he's an amazing printer. He's basically, I've given him Chuck's prints over the years, and he's matched them, and he's done a great job on new work as well. So the way my books work is the final product is not the negative, it's the print. The negative is a first offering. I look at it like this. I write the music and somebody plays it. I take the picture and these people who know how to print, like I learned how to print from Sid Kaplan, that's a big deal, but I still suck compared to guys who can really do it. And so he makes the prints, we put them on the wall, We figure out which ones are best. So that's the first print. Then the print goes. I take the print per se. I bring it to Joe Channon, who's the Joe who travels with me, who's been making high-end, as his job, he's a photographer, high-end catalogs for Tiffany's and Mercedes and Tom Ford. You know when you get that catalog in the mail, it looks like it was really expensive, and you're like, God, they wasted their money making this? He makes them. He scans the print. We get it on the computer. We sort of play with it. That's Joe, the silhouette of a ghostly Joe. We figure out where we want it to go, matching the print, if that makes sense. We want to get as close as possible. But also considering when you go on press, it's offset, which is ink on paper, which is never, it's always a surprise. But Joe has gotten us so close because he's so good at it, the surprises are at a minimum. So anyway, he does that. Then we make a thing called match prints. If you're in advertising, this is all like, you know what it is. And that match print, the thing with the color coding on the bottom, is sort of what you're going to use when the book comes out to say, does it look like this match print? This is our like file that we're giving you. And so we compare those to the print. That's actually a print next to it. Are we close? You can see we want it a little darker. We do that. Then we go to whatever printing place it is. We go to Meridian. They make this thing. This is a plate. And that thing on there is it's what you print from. The ink sticks to that and nothing else. There's actually three sets of them because it's four color. But anyway, that's what it looks like, the thing in the machine. He then runs paper. The printing press runs this paper and it comes through and some sheets come out. And they're all disorganized, they're upside down and backwards, because when you fold a book, it makes sense later. And we got him to write no plan B, because how cool is that? And so Joe's now looking at it versus, I don't actually know what he's doing. I guess he's looking at it versus that thing. Now he's actually looping it. And this is about registration. You know when you see like comic books and they look out? So this is to check registration and also to check the way the ink is laying. Joe has theories about ink, it totally makes sense. He wants certain inks on top, like the grays, in a different way than not everybody does, because he believes in this absorption thing. So we let Joe do that. This is, again, matching the print against what was printed at the place. This is the stuff we didn't use. And this is really cool. When you're at Meridian, you can see Leif Rhiannlander's books crumpled up and put in there. Nick Brandt's book, you know, of those big elephants and all that stuff, they were running that at the same time we were doing my book. It was just cool to see it all. Good stuff. So this is now, they have piles of, this is my book, or one page, or one, it's called a form. One form, there's four on each side, that's eight pictures. It dries, it sits there. This is a thing called, well, this is actually the fold. Fold and gather, if you know that expression. And they folded and gathered it in like a Xerox to make sure everything worked. Now, I have to sign that. That's, or the client pays for it. Because that's him going, is this right? Because we're not responsible at this. And you actually sign that. You sign every sheet. So like when Richard Bram, we made Richard's book at Peanut Press, he's signing as he goes. He's making decisions on press. And I don't see how a book can be made without a person doing that. How do you trust somebody who doesn't know what your work's supposed to look like? You know, could you get close? Yeah, but it would never, so I think that's valuable. I think Richard would also agree that that was important. You know, you ship it off to China, you save 30%. You don't know what's coming. It could be good. I'm not saying it's not. Oh, okay, so now I get all the gathers, and they're like, this is your book. We're not going to bind it yet. Make sure before we now pay for binding that this is right. And you literally sit there, and you go through each one. You go, is this right? Is this right? And of course it is. But, you know, you're never confident until you're holding the thing. This is the first ship, the ship to New York City. That's down in Tribeca. And this is what showed up in L.A., which is where headquarters is. That was loaded into a garage and now has to be distributed by our crack team. And that's it. Fini! That's how you make a book.
Whether you're a hobbyist or a professional, B&H has the answers to your questions. Experience a world of technology at our New York City Superstore. Connect with us online or give us a call. Our staff of experts is happy to help.